Welcome to Sunday morning worship at St. Paul's Lutheran Church in Orrstown, Pennsylvania. This is the fifth Sunday after Epiphany on February the 7th, 2021. I'm Pastor Bill DeHaas. I'm glad you're here today to share in this time of worship. I pray that you will be blessed through this time today. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Everlasting God, you give strength to the weak and power to the faint. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness, that your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. This is a reading of the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark in the first chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. As soon as Jesus and the disciples left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came, took her by the hand, and lifted her up, and then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring town so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Grace to you and peace from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Most every congregation has some form of prayer ministry, especially for the healing of others. It's very common in the prayers of the day during Sunday worship. People are lifted up in prayers and in some form or another. At St. Paul's, we have a prayer list, and we pray for healing for those people every week. Well, that is when we have in-person worship. When I arrived at my final call in July of 1998, I was told that the congregation had the practice of placing prayer request cards in the pew racks. It gave an opportunity for worshipers to write down a name or so of folks who needed healing in one form or another. We would collect them and then read the names out during the prayers. But in time, there were so many people listed on each card, and there were so many cards that we received, we had to make a change in the way we were lifting up those in need. No matter how a congregation does it, all of this shows how much healing, in whatever form, how much healing is needed in the world today. We bring people before God and we ask for healing in Jesus' name. In some ways, it's not a lot different than what people did in Capernaum in our gospel reading this morning. In this first chapter of Mark, we have a rundown of just one day of Jesus' earthly ministry. We heard the first part last Sunday in the gospel with Jesus teaching and healing in the synagogue in Capernaum. And here we finish this day after sundown, as Mark says, where the people of Capernaum were bringing all who were sick or possessed with demons. In fact, Mark says that the whole city was gathered at the door. Now, I've read that the population of Capernaum in that day and time was probably around 1,500 persons, so that must have been quite a scene. Actually, I don't know how 1,500 people would even get close to a door in a house in that day and time. Maybe it's just Mark's way of saying is there was great concern for the ill and the possessed of the town. And Mark tells us that Jesus cured many who were sick, and he cast out many demons. And I'm thinking, not all? What's going on here? Well, anyway, we continue to bear people to Jesus in our day and time and seek healing for them and for us. What do we want from healing? What is the result of healing? Well, that's where I think we go back to the beginning of this story today to hear the very first part. Here, Jesus and his disciples leave the synagogue where Jesus had been teaching with authority, where he removed an unclean spirit from a man. And they went to the house of Simon Peter. However, there was a problem. Simon Peter's mother-in-law was sick with a fever. So Jesus took her by the hand and raised her up, and the fever left. And Mark says that she served them. You might get the impression here that Jesus was being a little self-serving in his healing. Maybe he was hungry and he needed her to get out of bed and make some food. Well, that's hardly the case. There's two lines of thought of what it means here when it says she served them. One is that since she was the matriarch of the home, Jesus was not just healing her from a fever, but he was also restoring her to a place of honor, her place of honor. When it says that she served them, it didn't literally mean she did all the cooking. There were others in the household capable of that. But it meant she was able to take her place at the table as the head of the house and extend hospitality to all and to this stranger, Jesus. See, hospitality then was a big deal. The other line of thought is that this is also symbolic of the attitude that one has after being healed by Jesus. Jesus serves us so that we can be servants on his behalf. In other words, our response to Jesus' blessing, in whatever way we receive that, is to become a servant, to become a blessing for others, to become a channel of healing for others. As Simon Peter's mother-in-law moves from being cared for to caring for others, she really does become a model. Sometimes we do need Jesus' care and healing and transformation, but it doesn't end there. We are also to be the ones who care for others. So often I've encountered people who believe that being blessed by the Lord, being healed by the Lord, is an end in itself. So when people need healing or they're having problems or they need help, they seek the Lord. That may translate over into suddenly showing up for Sunday worship or becoming fervent in prayer. But then when the crisis is over, it's almost like, thanks, Lord, I'll see you again when I need you. I had a woman in one of my former churches who was very sporadic in worship attendance. One day I saw her at a convenience store, and it had been 2 or 3 weeks since I had seen her in worship, so I simply asked if she was okay. Her reply was, "I've had 2 great weeks, so Pastor, I really didn't need church." Well, we are blessed so that we can be a blessing for others, and that is the model that Simon Peter's mother-in-law gives us today, however we want to understand her response. We are blessed, and we blessed. And sometimes I've seen that happen all at once. In my first call, there was a woman named Evelyn who had been a registered nurse by profession, but by the time I got to know her as her pastor, she had suffered a series of medical issues, leaving her hardly able to get up and around, and she was hurting most all of the time. It would take her a couple of minutes to walk the 10 or 15 feet from her kitchen table to answer the door, but she always insisted on doing that. And the odd part is that even in the state where even in the state she was in, where it would have been more normal, I think, simply to withdraw or to feel sorry for herself. She continued to minister to people, mostly over the phone, but sometimes in person. Many a time, people would call her about medical issues or guidance or what to do with a sick child in the middle of the night. Sometimes people just needed a listening ear or a wise word of advice. It was often I got in my car after visiting her and I had to wonder who was really blessed by our time together. Well, thank God for Jesus' healing and preaching ministry. And thank God for the final healing that we will receive in the life to come, won by the death and the resurrection of Jesus. Ultimately, you see, all the healings that Jesus conveyed and all the ways that we are healed in the here and now are really foretastes of what will be. They are glimpses of the fulfillment of Jesus' final purpose, to restore and renew this whole creation. The last thing I wanted to say about our reading today is it does bear a reminder for us. For us to be the best servants of the great servant, we cannot neglect ourselves. In Jesus' earthly ministry, it's evident that he did take time for himself. He was the most authentic human being to ever live, and yet he still needed his times of refreshment and restoration. After this busy day in Capernaum, Jesus gets away by himself to be in prayer. Jesus gives us a picture of balance here, of balance of work and prayer, of caring for others and caring for self. Living in the amazing grace of God is not just for the other, but it's for you as well. And in that way, you and I can continue to be a blessing to this world that so desperately needs it. Amen. Trusting in God's power to heal, let us offer prayers for all who are in need. We pray for the church's many ministries of healing, for hospital, hospice, and military chaplains, for those serving in prisons and camps and institutions, for all bishops and pastors facing illness of which we are unaware. We pray for the health of the earth, for its myriad animals and their habitats, and for all created life that has been harmed by human misuse. We pray for the health of people around the globe, especially in this time for the people of Ethiopia and India, for international health organizations, for local and national medical services, and for school officials and teachers facing the pandemic. We pray for wholeness in our nation, for safety for our nation's elected leaders, and for an end to domestic violence, for an end to prejudice, and for an end to civic terrorism. We pray for a halt to the pandemic. We pray for all those who have contracted COVID-19, for health workers, for the prompt distribution of vaccines, and for all who today will die from the virus. We pray for all who are sick, suffering, those with chronic pain, those experience despair, for infants born impaired, and for the aged in decline, and for all whom we name before you from the silence of our hearts now. We pray finally for ourselves, for steady trust in your power, and for health amidst our weakness. We praise you for the faithful departed, for their lives of service to others. And we pray that despite sickness and death, at our end we will join with them to find our wholeness in you. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.